Okay, welcome everybody. Today we have a very special event as part of the public program of the Escuela de Arquitectura y Estudios Urbanos at Universidad Torquato di Tella, as part of the ongoing cycle conversations. Ana Font, professor of the school and coordinator of Archivo de Arquitectura, will be having a conversation with Pier Vittorio Aurelli, whom we're very glad to have here with us today. Let me make just a very brief introduction to the cycle and to the agenda, and I will hand it on to Ana and Pier Vittorio, and after that we can open questions to our floor that we are having today with us, faculty of the school and students from the thesis level at the undergraduate and master in history and theory as well at the graduate level. The cycle, as I was saying, is called Conversations. That's been ongoing for several years now. And conversation merges the ideological, biographical, and historical record to characterize the experience of architects with an established trajectory. The cycle promotes a type of learning supported by the discussion and post-rationalization of empirical knowledge built through the sedimentation of the practice of architecture as a system of thought. Professors from the school establish close and incisive dialogues with the most influential architects in the local and global sphere about their professional, academic, and public action experiences. The conversations are relaxed and personal in tone and are followed, as I was saying, by an open conversation. And today we are starting with an agenda that has its double. And the agenda is called Skeptical Players. It has its double, that is Jovial Players. We've already had several other guests with us, and it will go on in the second semester. And the idea of Skeptical Players is to organize conversations between professors and architects who have positioned themselves as influential players on a planetary scale. The conversation explores different modalities in which the rules of contemporary architectural thought are radicalized, rethinking, distrusting, and also renewing the cultural and disciplinary sense of the deployment, combining criticism and play, the revision of established values on which architecture bases its relevance is sought through the radicalization of its reasons and the disbelief of its historical inertia, boldly addressing the sense of disciplinary specificity in the contemporary world. Skeptical Players investigates and researches the ability of architects to put in crisis the foundations on which to think architecture on a global scale. Without further ado, I pass it on to Ana and Territorio, and then we will open the conversation to our virtual floor.
Okay, well, thank you, Manuel. Thank you for this introduction. Sounds fantastic. I never heard you go through all the description of the cycle. It's really amazing. And what it's really nice to see also some faces in this virtual room that we have today and to reconnect against all odds in this kind of simulation of our lounge format, which is also, it's 1 p.m. in Buenos Aires and it's kind of this kind of lounge moment. And I'm very happy to welcome you, Territorio, to school. I feel this was a long due invitation. Actually, we have discussed many times with Ciro how nice it would be to have you. And we're very pleased that this is happening today. First and foremost, thank you for coming. And I want to be brief, but I will introduce you a little bit and the route map of the conversation, which is like a soft map. First things first, Territorio Aureli is an architect with whom anyone involved in the discipline in the last decades will have necessarily crossed paths. And I think this is partly due, I would say, to the fact that he operates simultaneously in different realms. One of them is his office, Dogma, which he founded in 2002 together with Martino Tatara. Dogma has worked on the relationship between architecture and the city and is active in offering consultancies to municipalities and agencies concerned with urban planning and architectural issues. And in the last years, they have been working on a research by design trajectory that focuses on domestic space and its potential for transformation. So this work has been widely exhibited and published. Before this kind of stronger focus on the domestic, there is a publication that came up in 2013, which is a catalog called 11 Projects, where it's possible to see a synthesis of the first kind of 10 years of production of Dogma. It's a very beautiful book. And this leads me into the realm of publication, which includes books and essays, of course, like the widely known The Project of Autonomy from 2008 and The Possibility of an Absolute Architecture from 2011. And more recently, The Room of One's Own or Loveless, Minimum Dwelling and its Contents, just to name some of them. He's also the editor of the collection of essays, The City as a Project, which is a result of a research collective that started within the PhD program at the Verlage and TU Delft. And this brings me to the last kind of realm, which is his teaching activity. And as many of you may know, his research unfolds currently in a couple of schools in the US, at Yale University, where he's visiting professor, and at the UK in the Architectural Association in London, where he runs a diploma unit and is director of the PhD program. So I would say that ultimately for me, all three realms are linked by an idea of research that is driven by a strong intellectual mobilization. And this is mainly the space in which I would like to kind of navigate today in our conversation and what moves your thinking, and how it has transformed along the different experiences that you've had. And to do so, and we might diverge and it's totally fine, but I will be opening some spaces with very small questions, like the questions are clearly not the center of this, but more just an answers of what we can discuss. And we will go around the idea of drawing and the idea of non-composition, which will take us to the influence of your first two books and the idea of archipelago and architecture as frame and the definition of what the architectural project includes. And because this is going to bring us to the political, we might speak about the relationship of the disciplinary agenda and the turns of the times, like the impact of the economic crisis in 2008 or the pieces of globalization in relation to the positions that implied theoretically in the previous mentioned books. And then I would like to turn a little bit into your geographic journey, like your own European project and the vector with American academia, to see how that plays in what you're thinking. And lastly, I will bring up maybe some discussion on research as space for problematization of the status quo, precedence building, and maybe we are lucky to hear what is your map of the field of forces in the current architecture scenario and end up with a more open kind of speculative conversation. So anyway, let's see how it goes. let's do it. If you want to, I'm afraid you're going to be muted, Vittorio, when we start. But can you unmute yourself? You cannot, Manuel. I was thinking that could happen.
Yes. Now.
Cool. Anyway, well, hi. So I'm just gonna start with something very silly, and it might kind of be shocking. But I was asking myself if you still draw in ink. You do?
Yes. I draw a lot. Actually, it's something I do almost every day.
Really?
Oh, yes.
I wasn't expecting that answer.
Yes, I draw a lot. Drawing is a very important thing to me. I also paint. And it's something I try to do as much as I can. Of course, I need time, but I try to manage to have time for it. Yes.
That's great. What are you doing right now? Like, what do you have a plan, or you are more into this kind of like the BETS project, where you have this kind of, do you set your rules and you have series or?
Yes, I will always work on series of drawings. So I don't draw like a one-off drawing. Of course, there are different kinds of drawings. I mean, sometimes I sketch or draw for work we are doing at the office, although in the work we do at the office, we avoid as much as possible the sketching. I mean, we always try to work in a more kind of shared way with very simple parties. But then I draw a series of drawings which are a reflection on themes or motifs that interest me in architecture. And like, for example, the idea of the non-compositional, but recently I'm working also on other series. I work through series. I work through like a series of sometimes 50, sometimes 100 drawings.
Mm-hmm. That's super interesting. Now, because I was looking at that exhibition in particular, because I didn't know, I came across it recently, which are 36 drawings, right? And there is this sequencing and the unfolding of the rules. And then to me, when I looked at those drawings and the ones, for example, of the project, like A Simple Heart, and there is this statement that you put forward very early in the early years about architectural form being reduced to a sort of essential kind of nature, right? And not being architecture, what is being visible, but what happens within architecture. And then actually I was thinking, because the recent drawings, more like the office drawings on domestic space, are these plans that are like perspectives from above, right? And there are no lines. So I wanted to, I don't know, to know what is this kind of motivation of the duality, you know, like the role of the line and the role of the texture and how, I don't know, if you maybe can speak about that.
Yes, in fact, the drawings I do myself are, you know, very simple. I mean, unfortunately, I don't have an example here, but usually I draw very simple abstract forms, which are more like elaboration for me of specific themes. While these drawings that, for example, the one I sent you to advertise this conversation. These are more part of a research we have conducted in the last 5-6 years on domestic space. And actually it's almost the opposite of these more abstract drawings, because these drawings on the contrary show the way in which architecture becomes this vessel where habits and ways of dwelling unfold. Well, actually, in the drawings you mentioned before, like this series of drawings, like The Marriage of Reason and Squalor, I was doing exactly the opposite. I was trying to imagine an architecture where any precondition about dwelling is erased. So in a way, they are almost like the opposite of each other. These two type of drawings.
There's like the erasure of the problem of the program in a way, no? In the
yes, actually, which for me was very important in that series. That's the idea of the non-composition, which maybe we can discuss later. Well, actually, these drawings on domestic space is the opposite, because domestic space is one of the most charged kind of architecture in terms of maybe not program, but routines and habits, and how often they looks to us very natural, but in fact, they have been carefully choreographed and constructed through specific social and political, sometimes projects.
I've heard you say like this kind of the idea of domestication, it's not natural, like it happens, right? So it's like a process. And yeah, you're making me think if that is something that it's like a, if it's reversible, like if it's like a, you know, like a one way and reverse, it would reverse to this kind of more kind of absolute spaces that you kind of conceive in the other drawings.
Yes.
Yeah. No, well, I don't know. I was starting with this and I really didn't know that you would say that. And it's really, really cool because also I was thinking, what was the influence towards yourself sometimes? Like when because I know, Aaron, you don't like the word influence, and I understand, and it's perfectly, it makes sense. But if you don't think yourself as an author of the project of autonomy or the possibility of an absolute architecture, right? If just as objects out there, and I mean the impact that it does, the language that is kind of not objectivized, right? Like this proposal of looking at architecture not as a something that has to constantly produce an excess of resources, and I don't know how has this evolved in you, and how do you see it kind of in others in terms of, you know?
Yeah. Well, it's difficult to talk about these things, I have to say, because as I told you before, when we agreed to do this conversation, since many years I lectured, but not about my work. I always lecture about other things. So it's difficult for me to now have to speak in the first person. Forgive me if I will not be as lucid as I should be, perhaps. Few things. I mean, one, of course, is the work. One aspect is the work of Dogma, which I share with my collaborators, and of course, especially with my partner, Martino Tattara. And in that respect, I think a very big important influence for us was when we met as a students in Venice in the late 90s. And there were certain professors that we really admire. One in particular, who is not very well known, but he was a very important figure of the Venice School. His name is Gianugo Polesello. He was an early collaborator of Rossi. He collaborated on the very early projects by Rossi, and then they worked individually. Rossi became extremely well known, and Polesello actually was not as well known as Rossi, and his work actually was very, very appealing to us because he was working on with a very reduced kind of language, using extremely simplified forms. And both Martino and I had the chance to be in his class, in his studio, And I remember that he really insisted on us using the most generic and abstract forms. And for him, this was not just a formal kind of strategy. For him, it was a way to make design a collective process. So he insisted that, you know, when you are an architect, you are always collaborating with other people, and every design move should be understandable. I mean, maybe we can have disagreements, of course, but I think you have to somehow rationalize as much as possible the design process. And Martino and I were extremely, we were very influenced by this approach and by this method, which we have developed until now, of course, in different ways. But of course, you have to understand that this was, you know, happening in the late 90s, when the idea of architecture was very different. In fact, even the Venice School at that point was very much in crisis, had lost actually its maybe momentum. But that was actually a very important influence. I mean, not only actually his work, but also this kind of tradition that I would call a rationalist project. Then, of course, there is maybe a bit more personal, if you want, Valhalla of influences. One in particular, I actually, I mean, sorry to be too autobiographic, it's something I don't like so much, but actually I always wanted to study architecture, but I also study painting. I went to the art school before starting architecture. I studied a couple of years in the Academy of Fine Arts, and it's until now, actually, painting is one of my favorite interests, let's say. Mm-hmm. And especially abstract painting. I mean, I had a very strong affection or interest into abstract painting. And especially the work of certain artists. One in particular I really liked was actually the early work of Frank Stella, especially his black paintings, which I'm sure you all know. And in fact, I took the title of one of his paintings for this series of drawings we were discussing before. So that was actually a very important, let's say, influence. I also interested in poetry. That's another very strong influence of mine, especially minimalist poetry. One author in particular, Robert Lux. And somehow, actually, I always thought that, that you know, what I wanted to do with architecture was to pursue that kind of, let's say, language, if you want, or approach or sensibility. But of course, I mean, then, you know, meeting with Martino and working on many projects, of course, these, let's say, influences are contaminated by all kinds of other influences.
Of course. No, but it, I when you said this thing about the collective, like the generic being like something that provides the collective kind of, I think that it's really interesting. I didn't know about this part, like this part of your Venice experience. And I think we will go to that later on, because you also said in a lecture that then you were forced to go to the Netherlands. And I think this changed some of your interests. Yes. So we will go there. But yeah, I mean, no, of course, it makes a lot of sense. There are like quotes of books in the A Simple Heart, for example. It's kind of the quotes of the drawings are from the book, so it's I can see that that will, and this idea of the language as and the idea of the essential or the absolute as well, which is, I think, it's really, really interesting. I don't know, because you brought up this Venice condition, and I was rereading something that you wrote in Locke magazine in 2010 about Afuri. And you were saying that that his project was misunderstood. Let's say it was not a retreat, but it was a search for the origin of strategic links, right? And to recuperate a sort of totality of the intellect and the possibility of transgressing some specializations in the discipline that are imposed actually from a political economy, let's say. And I was thinking how this applies to your own project. Mm-hmm. Like if when in 2008 and 11 you kind of argued against this kind of compulsion of modern culture. If that is linked to this historical moment, and how do you, yeah, so how do you see your own project in these terms, like in relation to that?
Well, first of all, I happen to be a student in Tafuri's class. I followed two classes, actually, 92-93 and then 93-94 when he actually died. And of course, this was an incredible influence. Tafuri was actually a brilliant teacher, a lecturer, and I would say much more than as he was as a writer. His writings were not matching the clarity and brilliance of his lectures. And unfortunately, the reception of Tafuri in the international, I don't know, actually, maybe in the Spanish world, I know it's different, but in the Anglo-Saxon world, has suffered a lot from the lack of clarity of his writings and the translation of this. So I think there is a problem of lost in translation in a way in his work, in my opinion. Although actually the translations are, the translators, I mean, I happen to know one of them, they really did their best to edit, let's say, his very convoluted way of writing. Which of course had moments of incredible clarity and power even in English. But actually Tafuri was a brilliant teacher. He would teach every week, and his lectures would last 2 hours each, and they were, for me, were really the most powerful introduction to architecture I could ever imagine. And but the Tafuri as a teacher is very different from the Tafuri that you might expect by reading his books, because especially these books that have been more successful, which is actually his early books, especially Architecture and Utopia and the Sphere and the Labyrinth. But as you might know, Tafuri actually worked a lot also on Renaissance architecture. Mm-hmm. And that's actually when I was a student of him. His classes were focused actually on Italian Renaissance architecture. Mm-hmm. And actually what is interesting is that Tafuri wanted us to be very literate about architecture. So of course he was interested in the political, ideological aspects, cultural aspect of architecture, but the first layer for him was to be very literate, very precise about architecture. And that was for me a very good a good introduction, because of course when you are young, you are very impatient to immediately dive into the more ideological, political aspects, especially at that time, because I was very much politically active. So I've read actually his early writings, but it was very good for me that he forced us to really understand first how architecture is produced. Not only from the point of view of the architect, but also from the point of view of the client, from the point of view of the urban strategies that are at play at that specific moment. And of course, for him, the Renaissance was a very important moment, because it's really the moment where the professional figure of the architect, as we know it, emerged for the first time, basically. And he really wants us to understand how that happened, in a way. Mm-hmm. So that was, for me, a very important moment, because it made me realize how crucial was this historical understanding of architecture, especially in a moment in the 90s where history and theory were somehow losing their appeal to students and to architects. Mm-hmm. So that was a very interesting moment. And that really was also important for me when I started to teach myself and to, you know, advance my my studies. Of course, there is a big issue here. Tafuri actually, at that time, he was extremely geared to separate history from design. As you might know, this is actually one of the most important aspect of his work. For him, the problem of having this, you know, practice and history too close to each other is that at a certain point, you tend to develop historical research almost as a kind of support of your work as a designer. And of course, I think he's right, and I don't disagree. Although I wanted to be an architect, I wanted to design, I wanted to make projects. So somehow, what I think has left from Tafuri's work in my work is that, that's at least my own impression, maybe people can have a different opinion. You know, I see my writings and my teaching also, as you have seen also, my teaching of architecture, not always, you know, actually almost not at all, trying to support my work as a designer. In a way, there is a tension. I don't like to, you know, to make my design work like the answer of you know, my work as a theorist or as a more researcher, let's say, about architecture.
No, yeah, I understand that. At the same time, I mean, it's not like an explicit kind of get together, but in a way, I don't know, but when you position yourself in that moment towards this kind of design without qualities or this, you know, in a way you're relating very much both things, I think, because not in terms of the product as an object or anything, but more like the position, like the kind of the ideological position, right? And yeah.
Yes, there is a relationship for sure. There is a relationship, but at least from my own point of view, and maybe, you know, I cannot pretend that people understand these things in my own terms, but in my own terms, I see more of a tension between these. Yeah. I mean, certainly they converge towards certain themes, no? Certain topics. But at the same time, they don't form like a monolithic or grand theory. For example, I never liked the kind of Venturi or Robert Venturi or Denis Scott Brown kind of method where the theory completely supports then, you know, the design approach. There is almost like a unity between what they write in their books and what they produce as architects. Certainly there is a kinship between the themes I'm dealing with my writings or my teaching and my work as a designer, but it's not a kinship that is like, you know, forcing me to, you know, to almost pretend that what I design is the final answer or is the consequence. Yeah. Not at all. I really don't like that kind of, situation, because I really believe that theory should not be just a way to support. Design should also be a form of inquiry, an inquiry that can even put in crisis what you do as a designer.
Okay, so I mean, you would say that you don't want this tension, because this tension on itself, it is a thing, like you can engage or not maybe with such tension. But I think now I understand that what you're saying is that you don't engage with this tension because then they cannot be challenged both ways. Like they become like partners in crime. And now if you don't kind of engage them, then they can make uncomfortable each other, like the theory and the kind of design condition. That would be that would be a way to put it, maybe.
Yes, also this has to do with my role as a teacher, because as you know, actually, especially in the last 10 years, I've been teaching classes on history of architecture, which is very very unusual. I mean, but you know, no one wanted to do the history survey that you know, we have to provide to first year students. Yeah. So I had to do that job, which actually turned out to be for me an extremely fruitful experience, because it forced me to really study history and almost forget about my work as a designer. And I think that it's something very productive. Not, of course, eventually this feeds your work as a designer, but I never try to force. And I also discourage students as you might know, to even read my writings or to read my books or to look to my work. And, you know, I said, just read what what you find in the syllabus. So that experience for me was really important and has shaped my pedagogy a lot. Mm-hmm.
Totally. No, I understand, like, the disclosure look on, and also that, yeah, sometimes it's a bit at the beginning for me, it was a bit shocking that you were showing things from, like, before Christ kind of dates, no, like really old, and then it would kind of genealogize itself into something that would take form, or like your project on platforms, for example. It just came to mind, no, like how the ground floor becomes like the ground of the project, and then you go to Utzon and Mies and Le Corbusier, but it comes from this kind of first reading. So I think, I don't know, I can imagine you like lecturing beyond the kind of prehistoric kind of things, but then it comes back. I'm advancing myself because I want to speak about precedence, but then I don't know, I'm going to kind of not follow the rules of my own game. But I was thinking of this, I always thought of you like, you're Europe, right? I mean, like I was studying in Barcelona, but then I spent kind of my adult life in America. And I always look back at your work and the way you look at history and the way you look at materials. And I always wanted to ask you, what is kind of this European project in your practice? Like what did it mean for you to be forced to go to the Netherlands, kind of face another language, I understand, like the so on and so forth, and then jump to be in Brussels, like you're in the center of Europe, and then now you are going to the US. Like, what does this map do to your thinking that you so far have spoken, like, from this kind of more kind of Italian background? How would you kind of rationalize a little bit what happened with you in terms of this kind of geographic vectors, let's say?
Well, actually, I never planned to be in the places where I ended up living and working. I think this is something common to everybody. I mean, you just follow like opportunities. The only, in fact, place where I really wanted to go was Venice, because actually I'm originally from Rome. At that time it was very uncommon for someone in Rome, because we had two schools of architecture in Rome, to actually move to Venice. But I really wanted to move to Venice to study there, because there were teachers that I really wanted to engage with. And I have to say that if there is a city that has a huge impact on my own imagination of the city, is certainly Venice. Mm-hmm. I've never recovered from the experience of living there for 6 years. And I studied the city a lot. And for me, actually, has become almost like a Denkbild And of course, it's very unfortunate that Venice now has this reputation of a tourist trap. And I know that many of you might have experienced Venice as an unbearable touristic hell. And it's a pity, because Venice actually, not only actually has a very interesting history, like many, many other cities, of course, but also a very conflictual history also. For me has really inspired, what the city is about, you know, this kind of archipelago effect of parts which never come together as a totality. They remain, actually, they embody this kind of tension. Mm-hmm. So that was for me like the city that really, for which I have the strong affinity. All the other places, as I said, they came to me just out of opportunities. I won a scholarship when I was a student, and I had to spend basically the scholarship abroad. And my English was really bad at that time, because in Italy we have this laziness about learning other languages. at least in my time. So I just went to the Berlage because it was the most affordable place, and also the only one that accepted me at that time. And it was actually a serendipitous situation, because I have to say, at that time, of course, Holland was very very hype, and the Berlage Institute was a very specific school, gathering a lot of Dutch architects, actually not only Dutch architects, but also architects from the AA. Actually, Ciro was one of the teachers at that time. And of course, for me, it was a bit of a shock, because I found myself in a context that I had nothing to do with. But it was a very productive shock. Actually, it's actually when I was there that I realized many things that were important to me. And also, I met very important persons. One of them certainly was Ilya Zengeris.
Mm-hmm.
And Ilya was a really big teacher, a very great teacher and a great mentor.
Mm-hmm.
And I was lucky to meet him, because that made that experience really special.
He was your PhD tutor, right?
Yes, actually, after I finished the 2 years of course, I went to work in Brussels. So that's actually how I moved also to Brussels. I worked for a few years with Xavier De Geyter, who was actually a former collaborator of Frank Colas in the maybe most the golden age of OMA.
Yeah.
And that was a very interesting moment, because I met also other interesting people working at Xavier, like Kirsten Geers and David Van Severen. Mm-hmm. So I think that was a very interesting moment where many of us started to think about a certain kind of direction of architecture, let's say a certain approach to architecture.
Yeah.
And then actually I had a chance to start my PhD. And so that actually was a plan that I had since before. I really wanted to teach. I wanted to write and to do research. And so I had a chance to do a PhD at the Berlage and TU Delft, and Ilya became my thesis advisor. And that was really a very important moment. I think the conversation, discussions, and then I happened to teach with him was an incredible galvanizing moment for me, as intellectually, let's say.
Yeah. And I believe you're linked to London eventually. But before that, maybe because you passed really quick with this kind of moment, and you mentioned some people, and there is people here in this audience that have been working for some of them. What happened in that moment? I mean, what happened with Kirsten and David and all this? I mean, what was the situation? What was the kind of mobilization for getting together? And I don't know if you can tell.
Well, I met Kirsten while I was working at Xavier. We became friends quite immediately, because we had very strong common interest, basically. Also, we liked a lot music. I mean, we had common taste about music. We both mm-hmm. liked new wave bands, so that was a very important thing.
That's bonding.
And of course, architecture, we were both very, of course, not very happy about the kind of architecture that was very fashionable at that time. And we had this strong interest in Rossi's work and that kind of architecture, let's say, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, you have to understand that Belgium, it's an interesting place, because in Belgium, there is a strong tradition of abstract art and also conceptual art. David, the grandfather, Dan Van Severen, is one of the most important abstract painter in Belgium, in Flanders, let's say. Mm-hmm. So in a way, it was this, there was a conversation. And then later, a few years later, we started to do some project together to see actually what you know, what we were trying to find, you know, as a kind of language of architecture, if you want.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, it was very important. Then, of course, the difference is that they dive very much into the profession, with I think really brilliant results. Martina and I were more interested in, we pursue actually our PhD, and we were more interested to teach and to also develop more theoretical and research projects, let's say.
This is something also because of thinking of them, like a couple of years ago, we kind of bumped into Kirsten in Chile in a workshop with some students from the school, and we had this thing where, and I don't know, this is another topic, no, but it's like this idea of decision of the of architecture as a decision that has to be made, and kind of this kind of condensation of the process of designing, as you don't want to deploy, or you would argue, I would imagine that you don't need to deploy the process of design as such, you know, like as a medium of, and then that's where we kind of clashed in that conversation, like this, and maybe this is because I'm just kind of bringing it up, no, but because the conceptual or the conceptualization, like the quick conceptualization that has actually many layers of decision making that are not kind of expressed, I think that is something that maybe I would say, to turn it into a question, because it's something that I think about often, and I think at the school it's a strong discussion that we have in general. I understand that, like the ideologic action that it causes in 2008-10, and the necessity probably of kind of shaking the ground of this. But how do you think about it now? Like, how do you think about this position? And even office, I don't think they dive into it so literally as much, no? But how do you feel about now with a certain distance in general?
But you know, I never try to be too much self-conscious about, you know, what is my role or position, or I mean, my strong, also because I feel very responsible towards students. I mean, and I always tell them, you know, don't look too much to this, you know, what the discourse, or you know, try to study architecture, you know, especially when you're at school, you know, you have this luxury to really go deep into things and not try to follow or catch on with the latest trend or this and that. At the time for us, it was more of the fact that any is, let's say, interest in historical inquiries was almost impossible. I mean, you know, everything was about the present. And I think to me, this is a problem also now. I mean, I see, especially with the school, I mean, and I think that for me, a way to understand the present is also look back to genealogies and historical continuities, rather than to always catch on with the latest idea. That has always been my conviction back then and now. So I've not changed in that respect. And I always try to really tell the students, you know, okay, maybe you can, I mean, I'm not saying that you should shield yourself from those more current discussions. It's just that sometimes it's very productive to look to wider perspectives.
Yeah.
And that was actually what at that time was the motivation for this, for us to do what we were doing. So there was no kind of an avant-garde strategy, you know, okay, we have to make room for ourselves. I was very unhappy about a certain, I mean, for me, the problem that I experienced at that time was that there was this very strong idolatry to certain kind of ideas of architecture, which unfortunately were represented by figures like Rem Koolhaas, you know, and his writings and his style of research, you know, that was, the Bernardi was completely influenced. I mean, maybe Ciro, I mean, Ciro actually was an exception. Ciro was not following, so not, he was an outsider in that respect, but the most of the work that we were doing at the Berlage was really this kind of AMO or kind of, you know, encyclopedic scanning of everything that was happening, of the whole complexity and contradictions of the world. And of course, we were very unhappy. We were very dissatisfied. I was extremely dissatisfied by this. Also the level of superficiality and how it fed the design. You know, design was becoming just this kind of endless process iteration of, and so we were very, very unhappy and tried to actually construct a different space for ourselves, you know, with our own references, with our own problems, let's say. But I think for me that has remained. I don't know now, of course, I mean, it has to evolve. I don't think you can rely just on the moment of rupture. You have to sustain your work and try to develop themes and ideas. So in that sense, this is actually what happened in the last years.
I mean maybe we dive into the rupture moment, because I know it's kind of, we're interested in this as well, but going forward and in what happened also, I mean, to me, of course, I have this kind of line where I'm interested in how the PhD space has become a place where to kind of rehistoricize and to kind of by problematizing certain notions to take them out of their common understanding. And I think there is something that you are doing, like continuously in that line. And I don't know, maybe just very silly question, like how productive is that modality? Like how is this space a good space to do that in a sustained way and not as a kind of ideological way?
Yes, no, I mean, thank you for this point, because for me it's very important. Actually, I think this pedagogical experience I've been involved with in the last 10 years, the PhD program, but also my teaching of history and theory, and my collaborations with students and with doctoral students have been extremely important. And I think this is really a work that have contributed to my maturity or my evolution immensely. And I don't. I think that I also felt that that what we do is nurtured by collaboration. And somehow I also regret that sometimes I'm attributed certain ideas that I also developed with other people. For me, the idea of collaboration and being part of a community is extremely important. Without that, there is no way we can produce knowledge. And I've been trying to cultivate this as much as I could through my pedagogical experience, through my practice, which is actually a collaboration of different people. So for me, this is very important. And I don't like this way in which, fortunately, it's a very distorted way in which often our work is presented as the product of one figurehead. I think it's of course the kind of media usually digest. But I think this figurehead syndrome is very problematic in my opinion. Of course, I take my responsibilities for what I write and say, but I've always been part of this very intense exchange with other people. This is for me very important, yes.
No, I can see it and I know that also, like what you are, the topics that you are kind of focusing on lately for a while, or the idea of the domestic, which is not something that is your interest clearly, like something that is broader and it takes different paths somehow. And maybe I'm curious to know maybe what is your relationship with this kind of broader map of how these, the same interests kind of spread? Like, do you have any, I don't know, like any desire, or do you have any thoughts sometimes of kind of the overall form of, like, you know, like the scales of the project, like somehow you have a project in your table and then there are other scales. Do you have a consciousness of that, or is something that just kind of happens?
No, there is a degree of decision to explore or to work on certain themes. For example, as you mentioned, in the last 10 years, I've been intensely working on the domestic space, both with my projects, but also with my writings, and also especially with my teaching. And of course, this has been a collaboration also with other people in Primis, with, of course, Martino, who's my my associate at Dogma, but also Maria Giudici, we teach together at the AA, and Maria actually was very important because she introduced me many years ago to feminist writings, which for me was a key to really understand the problem, the historical problem of domestic space. So you see, actually, you know, these collaborations are important because sometimes they really open up new path. And of course, this research on domestic space, as for me, was important because it forced me to re-question some of the earlier themes that I was investigating. So in that sense, there is a level of decision. There is a level of where you say, okay, you know, I really want to investigate this topic, and I think that was certainly with the first work, which was more about urban form and its relationship to architecture, and then this path of research on domestic space. But now I would like to go back to the question of urban form. In fact, I'm planning to work in the next time on a political history of urban form. But of course, this work on domestic space was extremely important because it totally forced me to rethink certain categories and concepts through which I could deal with this topic.
I see. Yeah, that's good that you're making a disclaimer here, like something is coming after this. And yeah, also I sometimes thought that this idea of the island and the kind of the house and the island were still like something that was in the background of what you're saying, no? In all scales, like across the different scales. But yeah, maybe just because I think I lost track of time a little bit, but to link it to current kind of projects that you are dealing with in terms of, I don't know, I was thinking competitions even and your commissions, because I understand that your commissions are linked. I mean, it's not completely segregated, like you are working on prototypes for housing they can build differences, like the users can build differences inside of this. And so you design even the constructive system that would imply to be in one of these units. And so you have this line of research. So maybe just a question and then I will have another one to close up and open to the general conversation. If you can speak about how you kind of bridge this interest in the domestic into these kind of prototypes that you're developing at the office a little bit.
Yes, actually, these projects are mostly projects that were developed for exhibitions or for research that was funded. And also we are trying now to engage with the real construction, let's say. Although we really wanted to focus on more experimental models, which sometimes are difficult and challenging to be immediately realizable. Nevertheless, in spite of this, a very important aspect of this research was to really go deep into the political economy of domestic space. So not to focus only on the typological aspect, which is very important, perhaps the most important aspect of our contribution. But also to the economic forces that produce domestic space, because as you know, that one of the major change of the last 100 years in the architecture of domestic space is that domestic space is no longer something that has a use value. I mean, domestic space today has an exchange value. It's a commodity. And this commodification, of course, of domestic space has very problematic consequences. I think don't even have to mention them. And so the question when, you know, for us was, can we think of domestic space as a project that from the typological aspect, which is maybe the more disciplinary vantage point, through which to analyze domestic space, can we go from there to actually the political economy that produce domestic space? And that's actually, it's a very important aspect because it allowed to see different economic and social modalities through which public space and domestic space has been produced, affordable housing, which is also a very ambivalent condition, not always very positive, but also forms like community land trust, cooperative housing. So we were became very interested in the also in the functioning and in the history of this politics of domestic space. And now we are trying to put all this research together, let's say, to see if there is a coherent, if you want, form of this work.
Yeah. I see. No, yeah, that's super interesting. I mean, because also because of the kind of holistic nature of what you just described.
Yeah.
Because it's not just because, I mean, and there is this kind of political correctness sometimes in certain kind of realms of work, like concerns and so on. But what you're describing is kind of, is the holistic project behind something that it's driven from the discipline, and then it studies the mechanisms, and then it has like the whole process laid out, no? And to me, that is like, to be able to understand that it's made of all these components, it's really important. Because maybe just to kind of to end, and because I we've been speaking for an hour, it's, how do you see this field of forces in architecture right now? Like, because it's become very much more multiple, I believe. Like there are so many trends, and there is like no, somehow it's difficult, or maybe it's my vision, to see kind of ups and downs. Like there's like a multiplicity in a sort of flat plane, right? And I think what you're proposing, for example, would be something that could drag like a whole process of practicing architecture in a direction. And yeah, I don't know. And then maybe you're facing, the other day you mentioned something like very as a joke almost, but this idea of the beige architecture and this kind of new green, that you were doing a competition where you had to forcefully use, I don't know, wood as a structure material, right?
Yeah.
And so how do you see when you are in a stance, when you are looking at the holistic project that it's at stake for kind of the discipline, and then you kind of face this bubbles of meaning that somehow, I don't know how they fit. How do you politically think of this? How do you think this scenario that we are kind of in now, it's interesting to be approached or avoided, or getting to the friction that you were saying, maybe not getting to friction sometimes is a good position to take, or getting to friction with these things. I don't know, what is your impression? Maybe more informally, it's not like any kind of big answer of what we should be doing, but yeah. How do you feel in that scenario, let's say?
But for me, is we all agree and maybe and aware that that architecture, I mean, historically has always been extremely embedded in institutions of power. Aldo Rossi used to say that there is no an architecture of opposition, because architecture has always been produced by the ruling class. And I think this is something that, you know, it's a very tough prospect for anyone who wants to find alternatives to the way in which architecture is produced today. And certainly I wouldn't claim that our work was like kind of an heroic effort to break through this condition, because actually also, even if our work has remained largely on a theoretical, let's say, level, but even within that theoretical level, we have tried to find ways in which we can even compromise just to learn how the mechanism works. Mm-hmm. And for me, that has been very important. to understand the way in which architecture is produced in the most, in the utmost, let's say, clear terms, and use the project as a test, as a tool through which you understand this. And I think that on one hand, we should not despair. I think there are always possibilities to advance something. But at the same time, we should also be very sober and not to overestimate our agency, to not think that architects can have a big vision that can change. Maybe that also what has changed a little bit vis-a-vis my early work, that I, by studying architecture, by studying it's the way it has been produced historically, has allowed me to also be very prudent in not to overestimate its possibility to allow us to transform and to think, the world.
Okay. Well, maybe it's, thank you so much. I mean, I would just go on speak on stuff, but I think it's fair to open to the gallery, because we have all this audience. So Manuel, I don't know if you want to pick up.
I think it's been a wonderful conversation. I have many questions I could do, but let's start first with the questions that will arise from the gallery. I know what I want to start, just unmute yourself and go ahead.
Well, I could ask something. Hi.
Hello.
Hi. Well, I wanted to ask you about the website of your office. I mean, what importance does it have to you as a space in which your the work of different times and different areas of your life and your partners have a confluence? And because for me, these spaces are very important, and how they are curated and how they are presented. And I can see in the website of your office that some projects are displayed. Mm-hmm. And I mean, many projects are listed. Some are displayed and showed, and others not. And sometimes those things are related to, concrete problems or timing or whatever. Mm-hmm. So, and also the space of a website or a portfolio has, in general, I think, it's like a space of compression for the work. Like, so on one hand, there's the illusion that that all the work can be organized and showed, but also there's like a force from outside, like compressing and maybe limiting or maybe not limiting, I don't know. So I was very interested in knowing your thoughts and the role of your website or the website of your office in your thinking. Like if you're looking at it all the time and it's like a mirror, you know.
Well, actually, if there's something that has always been our nemesis, is the website. Actually, initially we didn't have one. Then we had one only with few images. But a lot of people were, few people actually were complaining that we can't see what you're doing. And so we try to put some, but we have never been really focused on the website. Let's say, I think it's a very rudimental one. And it's okay. I mean, I for us is good. Actually, we have always find the most congenial form of way to present our work is through books. I very much like the book. I know maybe sound very regressive and conservative, but there is something in the book that that I found extremely congenial, because there is this way to mix drawings and text that I don't know. I also don't. I don't like so much things online. I mean, I don't read much things online. I mean, I read, of course, but most things that I can download and print. So in a way, the website is our website is for me is okay, but it's not something I've been consciously designed. Maybe it's wrong. Maybe it's a mistake. But certainly, it's always been a bit of a struggle to use it. You know, because also in our projects there is a lot of text. There is you know, I don't know. It's difficult to sustain to find a good way to present this work through the web. But we're trying to update it sometimes. So maybe we'll get better in the future.
Okay. Yeah. Let's see if we have another question.
Maybe I'll jump on the table a little bit. No, I was curious. I have a lot of questions. Thank you, Pier Vittorio. But probably the most I'm curious about are two, which are related. One is related to your uncertainties or doubts. What are your, at present, your most kind of intriguing or unresolute or difficult uncertainties or doubts about your own work in terms of its validity or in terms of its relevance or its effect? Basically the cultural politics of your work, if it has changed, if you have doubts about it, if it has diluted somehow, somewhere, or you feel that it's in a process in that direction, where, you know, that's one. The other is, and I think it's related to that, is because you talked about kind of cooperating with students or with other people. So I was wondering, what's the spectrum of that realm of collaboration in terms of collaborating with enemies, basically, or collaborating with people that diverge from your own work radically?
Mm. Well, regarding the first question, of course I have a lot of doubts. I mean, but that has always been the case. I mean, that's also the idea of having dogmas is exactly that, you know, to put an edge. Otherwise, you would doubt about everything, and I'm a very self-doubt person. Actually, I'm not someone who has I have certainties, of course, and I have principles more than certainties. I mean, I have very strong principles, and sometimes I am able to follow them. Sometimes I'm not able to follow them, and that's what matters to me. I mean, you know, relevance is something I've never asked myself. I mean, I'm always surprised that there's someone reading my stuff. You know, like sometimes when I write, I have this question. I mean, I always think, well, if there are like 5 people that read what I'm writing, that's good. You know, that's, I accomplish my job. So I've never really tried to think about, you know, it's something that is also beyond our control. I mean, whether it's our work is diluted or I have to say that, you know, when I was student and even now, there were always someone who inspired me. And I hope that, you know, that might be the effect of my work, maybe, I don't know, to few people. And I think if that happened, I'm very happy, and I feel very, you know, very, very happy about it. But I've never tried to be too self-conscious about, you know, the influence of my work, because this is something also that can be very destructive and drive you to do things that are not what you really want to do, actually, because you want to, of course, appear or defend. In fact, this is the weakness of a lot of architects. At a certain point, their public presentation becomes more important than what they really want to do, no? And I really want to do what I want to do. I mean, I'm a very strong interest, a very, like everybody. I mean, I'm certainly not the only one, And of course, this goes to the second question. Of course, I think when you collaborate, you have to share some strong interest. Even for a moment, you know, it can maybe it doesn't last for too long, but I think there should be some very strong common interest. There could be difference, could be, of course, debate within collaborations, but I don't think you can collaborate if you don't have that interest, that kind of common ground of a theme or a topic that for you and the other person becomes very important. And the second thing is that, you know, within the intellectual milieu, I don't like this idea of enemies. And to be honest with you, Ciro, I never find polemics really my own. I've never been at ease with polemics, with polemical positions. I always found polemics a bit mediagenic, no? Like it's where everybody wants to hear, like, you know, people, I don't know, killing each other, you know, of course, intellectually speaking, you know, hopefully. And, you know, the AA all sometimes had that tendency. They want to turn, you know, they want to see you as one project against another project. I have to say, I really don't like this kind of, let's say, representations. I found them always infruitful. There is something that always struck me about Foucault. Apparently, at a certain point, I mean, after, you know, the first part of his work, when, you know, he became, of course, very well known, he said to some of his colleagues, I don't want to do polemics anymore. I just want to study, you know, I just want to dive into the, and that's actually my own approach. So in that sense, collaboration for me is a workshop, is a very strong moment in which with other people you work towards a theme, towards a topic. And if there is no that common interest, it's very difficult, of course, to collaborate. You can discuss, you can have a discussion, of course, which sometimes can be also very fruitful, but not really a collaboration.
Maybe just to point out something there, because maybe it's the idea of counterpart, which you actually bring up in some of your writing, because it's like, how to claim something, and first you have to kind of identify maybe your counterpart. So maybe that will be another notion, which is not an enemy, but no.
But the counterpart is not like it's not about people. It's not about individuals. You know, you against I don't know someone else. No, the counterpart is more different ideological blocks or different beliefs. Different ideas of the city or different ideas of society. So in that sense, the counterpart is certainly not something you can reduce to individuals, exactly. Like, you know, project by this person against the project. I think that is, unfortunately, the tendency of a lot of contemporary historiography, you know, to identify, again, like, as I said before, these kind of figureheads and then play this kind of game where there is the project of this person against the project of that person. But I really don't believe in that kind of construction. I think if there is struggle, if there is conflict, is something that is much larger than our own individual contributions. Let's say our are just contributions to something larger, hopefully, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anybody is thinking of something?
Okay, maybe while people are thinking, I had a question. You spoke at different moments of the conversation about methods, about the Venturi method, theory and design as a unity, the Dafuri method, theory and history and design separate ways, even the AMO method, the encyclopedic, broader and so on. And obviously my question would be, what do you think about method as a means of production in general? and if you could speculate about your own method, but obviously not as a self-proclamation and so on, but more like a post-rationalization of what has been done.
That's a very interesting question, because of course when you teach the question of method is extremely important. I have an ambivalent relationship with method, because when it comes to my own writings and my own research, I try to not follow like a method, let's say, that is not just there is only one rule that I give to myself, to always talk about very specific things, to not try to immediately generalize issues. Even if I'm interested in general question or general topics, I always try to investigate them through very specific case studies. So that's very important for me. The second is that in terms of design, I really believe you have to have a method. And in fact, I would argue that for me, the weakness of a lot of architectural approaches is the lack of method. And I think especially when you teach or when you collaborate with others, to have a method that you can, of course, change. A method can change, can evolve, can even be abandoned at a certain point. But I think to have a method is extremely important because it allows the design process to be understandable. And of course, I'm not saying that my method is better than others. I have a method, but it's just my own method that I share also with other people. But I think the question of method is very important because it allowed it reified your own approach to architecture. So in my case, the method I pursue is what we were discussing before, this idea of non-composition. The idea that when you design, you should somehow construct a kind of logic sequence of operations. And of course, the origin of that logic is always arbitrary. But nevertheless, the process has to be very clear. That's what I really liked about design. And somehow it helped me to allow, to explain what I'm doing. And that's very important for me. I always ask students, as long as you can explain what you're doing, I think for me it's okay. I don't mind what is the final result, as long as you can explain it. There is a very beautiful text that I always liked a lot, and it's a text that I discovered when I was a student of Rossi, which is this famous text by Raymond Roussel, very famous French surrealist writer, who wrote at the end of his career, he wrote all these crazy books. And then at the end of his career, he produced this beautiful text titled How I Wrote Some of My Novels. And he really explained the method he used to produce these crazy books. And the method actually, in spite of the books, is very rational, is very precise. And I like that. I mean, of course, rationality is something we should question. Nothing is ever purely rational, but I like to be, when I design, I like to follow a very rational, I would say almost mechanic method. There is something in my method that is very dry and mechanic, and I don't shy away from that.
I'm sure we are all thinking many things right now regarding this. Just to fill you in, Pirvittorio, because if we were in studio, you would have seen things like materials that are around the school. And there is this this tendency of many studios, but especially thesis, because it's how Ciro kind of also introduced his method. And we do these kind of models that are made of variables, right? And these models have a very kind of strict way of being thought, and that gives space for, I think maybe we would use other words, but the fact that you go through it, it allows you to think other things at the same time, but you are actually in the action of sometimes even mechanically, like producing certain processes. And I think it's, I don't know, to me it's very interesting because I know, I'm not pairing it up, but I'm just saying that it's something that I believe it's in the mind of many of us right now after listening to you, how you're saying that you really like to go through this, to defining your method, and you're saying that you are sharing it with others. And maybe that, just follow up on that a little bit, like in terms of research, like because you're talking about design, but in terms of research, would you say that you have also like a method that can be kind of communicated?
Yes, I mean, as I said, I always try to work on very specific case studies, which is either a project or the work of an architect. Very seldom I've, or a specific trope. For example, in the theoretical work we have produced at the office, like the research on the room, the platform. So these are usually very specific tropes, usually very banal tropes. I'm very interested in very banal themes. I've never tried to find like the exceptional original theme. Actually, all the themes I've worked with are very banal. They're almost commonplaces. Because I believe that often are exactly those kind of common places, those very banal tropes that hide they are the most opaque. Like, for example, the room is interesting in that sense, because in a way the room is one of the most familiar kind of architecture we can experience. I mean, we are constantly inside rooms, especially now. And yet, when we did our research, our book on the room, and we started the, you know, many years before and gathering bibliography and reading, we realized that this theme was never actually systematically discussed. So if there is a method, in my research is always to work through very specific objects, very specific case studies, which usually start from really architecture. I always try to start my research, never try to look to the larger picture at first, but always dive into specific architectural problems. And then from there, try to see how these architectural problems becomes paradigms of larger issues. But for me, this, I'm an architect at the end. I mean, I'm rooted to, you know, for better or worse, to the limits of our discipline. I certainly don't try to make a celebration of our discipline, but I use its history to then look to larger questions, but always try to dive into architecture first. Yeah.
Okay.
And there are some other, I don't know if there are questions there that you want to introduce or
can I make a question, a quick one?
Sure.
Hi, first of all.
Hello, hi.
I'm currently studying your ideas around the concept of evolutive housing. And in reference to your investigation and book Loveless, you write that, and I quote, "Collective dwelling is a contradictory typology which has represented both luxury and poverty, freedom and oppression, solidarity and solitude." And this is a very hopeful and at the same time scary affirmation. And so I wanted to ask you, in your opinion, what tilts the balance in favor of each of these destinies?
Yes.
And what power does architecture have in this subject? Do you think that evolutive housing and this idea that the house can grow or kind of spread is a reliable path to look for freedom?
Well, I think that if there is a major problem to in the history of domestic space is that domestic space has been rooted in the concept of property. In fact, the very modern idea of private property, especially in its origins in Roman law is very much bind rooted to land property and especially the property of domestic space. In fact, the word domestic really embodies this kind of idea of, you know, not just inhabiting, but commanding a place. So for me, anything that, you know, if there is a, if we really seriously want to challenge domestic space, we have to start from there. But of course, this idea of architecture as a form of property was also very much embedded in the typology of domestic, in the typologies of domestic space. And for me, the typological aspect is very important as a way to both read architecture of domestic space, but also to criticize and eventually even to change the architecture of domestic space. But of course, this has to be done in parallel with, and of course, this is not just the job of architecture, with all kinds of attempts that have been pursued to challenge the idea of architecture as domestic space as property, as a space of property. So in that sense, we have a, in this kind of struggle, we have a very specific task as architects, which is the way in which typology has naturalized the idea of property. But of course, then we have to also work with a larger, let's say, milieu, who, you know, all these social movements and cooperative movements that really are trying to dismantle this link between domestic space and property. So any typological alternative should come from this conversation. So in my research, I really believe that you know, one of the fundamental problem of the way in which we conceive domestic space is really the idea of the apartment, the idea of the compound that is bespoke to the private family. And even actually, it's interesting to see that even if the family, of course, recently has undergone a very radical crisis, this kind of trope of the enclosed household, the enclosed compound, is still actually very, very strong. So in that sense, I think that if we want to challenge this, we have to both look should both manipulate the typology of domestic space, but also engage in a wider conversation with those for social forces or social movements that are right now really challenging the link between the private property and property in general, and of course, domestic space.
Okay. I was thinking about the relationship between the question and answer and the question and answer right before, and you mentioned case studies as part of a method, and I think this that you were developing is part of a broader approach, and it's a very simple question that is what do you think about case studies? How do you think about them? How do you build up the pool, and do you look for consistency or historical inertia or contemporary relevance?
For me, case studies should always be, of course, vis-a-vis your own research, a paradigm. It can be anything, in fact. Not necessarily have to be a work of a great architecture, let's say. For example, in this research we have done on domestic space, we have analyzed so many projects of domestic space that are certainly not within the kind of canonical history of architecture, but they have to have this power of being very specific, but also have this paradigmatic general quality. And I think this is very important, so that you can use them as examples. You know, that's the original meaning of the word paradigm. I really believe that a case study to be powerful should always be addressed as a paradigm, of a larger condition. I'm not in favor of this tendency to always to always make things unique. I'm against the idea of uniqueness. I think it's one of the biggest problems in the way in which our knowledge has been constructed, you know, like everything. I think uniqueness is should always be a uniqueness of a second degree. In other words, it should be something that is singular, but always have this power to be a general paradigm.
Right.
Of the theme, of course, that you want to, that you are trying to investigate. Yeah. And of course, actually, also, I have to say that in this selection of case studies, there is also very strong personal preference, of course. I mean, some of those case studies are also the architecture we like, or I like. I mean, for example, especially when I work on the work of specific architects, what is also implied is a strong admiration, whether it's Brunelleschi or it's Serlio or it's Durand or no Ungers. I mean, of course, these are also architects I like, I admire. I mean, that's, of course, a very, very common thing, but very important one, because often you really, you have to have a motivation. You have to have a very strong commitment to these things, because you will spend a lot of time with them. So you better like them, you better enjoy them.
Yeah. Okay.
Hello. Yep. Can I ask you a question? Hi, Pierre.
Yes, hi.
I have a question for you. Considering your knowledge and relation with history, do you consider that we are currently living through changing times? I mean, regarding our cosmovision in general, our relationship with nature and non-human, and even if you don't, how do you think, what do you think is the role of history in changing times in general? Like, do you think history should guide the change or tell you, show you what you don't have to do, etc.?
Well, of course, we have to be aware that historical knowledge is not only something very specific, especially to Western culture, but also its origin is not innocent. History has always been used as a way to fabricate a specific past in order to support certain instances in the present. So there is something very dangerous in historical knowledge, because it has always been used as a way to put forward certain kind of hegemonic ideas, no? That's actually its origin. The origin of history was exactly that. It was exactly the winners, if you want, of rewriting history in order to legitimize their own position. But I think that history can also be used in a very critical way. And I really believe that often the best way to understand the present is through history. Not because, you know, and of course not using history in a kind of historicist manner as a way to recuperate something from the past just because, you know, it's consolatory, but to understand these very long continuities. For example, this was for me very important in this research on domestic space, and as Anna knows, because she has been auditing our seminars, with Maria, actually, my partner, we really try to even assume the history of domestic space from the point of view of non-domestic societies, which means that we started to study even, you know, the life of hunter-gatherers, just to understand why we ended up with homes, with domestic space. And of course you can say, okay, this is a very long genealogy and, you know, what we can do with it today, you know, since actually it's now, we take for granted that a decent life can only be in a secure abode. But actually this long genealogy made us to think that in fact, domestic space is very unnatural. It's something that has been really constructed with very specific intentions, with very specific agendas. And so that's how history helps you to not take for granted certain kind of received tropes and ideas, especially, you know, within schools of architecture where we all have passed through that experience that the first design and we do as a student is a house. Now, as if, you know, that's the origin of architecture, but we know that that's not at all the origin of architecture, and certainly something that happened very late in our history as a human species. So that for me was a very good example of how history, even if I'm not an historian myself, it's a very useful device to frame our present predicament.
I think there must be many, many questions, and seeing faces of everybody here, I am sure lots of people are thinking about the relationships between what we do at the school and what you're presenting at the moment. I'm sure about that. Yeah,
it kind of broke my heart to see Santiago raise his hand, but I don't know. I mean, on the one hand, I think this has been very long, but it kind of I don't know. No, Santiago, do you have like? I'm really. I don't know why it kind of touched me the way you moved towards the camera. Do you want to say something, Santiago? Go ahead.
Maybe the famous last question, no?
The famous last question. Yeah, come on, go ahead.
Okay. Well, thank you. It's quite simple, but. My question was, there seems to be an acknowledgement from your side of like the complexity of the world we live in. And you describe it really like with a lot of details in your writings. And then there seems to be a very like strong process of synthesis on your forms and the forms of your mm-hmm. project. You talked about like the simplicity of form as a way of being able to communicate with other people, but I was wondering if well, for me, of course, communication cannot only be there because there's also other ways of communicating. So my question was if you could describe or what do you think is the relationship this kind of very synthetic project have with the complex world that they are part of, in a way.
Yeah, that's a very good point. Well, I always thought that, of course, the issue of complexity is very relative. You know, depends how you look to things, whether they're, you know, complex or not. And I think that certainly I wouldn't say that things are complex, but things are difficult. And certainly things, you know, the reality, especially the reality of our profession, is certainly very unstable, very precarious. But I think that I've never thought that this necessarily should be mirrored in terms of form. I don't believe that form should be a kind of mirror to, no, I think form is for me a frame. It's actually a kind of structure within which then I try to address, of course, things. I mean, in a way, in architecture, there is always something very necessarily assertive and reductive that we will never get rid of. And we have to be aware of that. So I think that in our work, actually, especially the work of dogma, there is that tension. On one hand, a will to understand this complexity that you, you know, whatever it is, and at the same time, the necessity to propose something and to make that proposal as clear as possible. And of course, between these two terms, there is a tension that I think, you know, it's impossible to solve once and for all. So our work as architects, I mean, as an architect, I don't pretend that I even able to confront this complexity, but certainly the idea of using simple forms allow you to start like a first step no? A first a kind of a frame in which perhaps something can be addressed. Yeah.
I think that was great, and it was a very good last question for Tony. Thank you for, and I'm glad we took it. And yeah, maybe I think it's time to close. I'm sure there are many more things to ask, but you've been very generous, Pirvittorio, and I'm really thankful for this talk. It was amazing. So yeah, thank you so much.
Thank to you, and it was very difficult for me because, as I said before, I've never actually done this kind of thing. In fact, I've done it because I had to do an interview recently, very reluctantly about the my past work. But I was together with Martino, so we shared the burden somehow. But it's very difficult for me to explain this from a kind of autobiographical perspective. But I think it was also very enjoyable to, of course, to talk to you and to Ciro and to all of you. Don't take too seriously what I've said. That's my strong recommendation, because what matters at the end is architecture and, you know, things that goes beyond more personal approaches. But it was very pleasant conversation for me as well.
Well, I'm glad, and I know we are all very very challenged, and it's going to remain as a thing to reflect back. But yeah, okay, well, it's always difficult to close, especially now that we just click a button, but we'll cross paths again with all of you. And thank you for all these people that's in the gallery. And it's very nice to see you guys. Honestly, we haven't crossed paths either. And thank you, Manuel, and for this. I don't know if you want to make the official.
Okay. Thanks, Anna. Thanks, Pirvittorio. We'll be in touch soon, probably. And thanks, everybody. And see you soon in the next conference of the school.
Okay. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye.
Bye.